Chapter 1058, finally out of Wano. We got a lot to discuss here. Warlord bounties, Straw Hat bounties. We're finally out of Wano. Finish leaving Yamato behind. The Straw Hats pack their things. They give Momo a flag. Wano is now part of their territory. Luffy, Law, and Kid pick three different spots on their log poses, and they separate. Now we're here in the new world, sailing with the Straw Hats. Big bad Emperor Straw Hat Luffy is getting massacred by his own navigator, who put him in a cage. Meanwhile, Jinbei, the new addition to the team, although I wouldn't really say new because Jinbei's been around for a long time. Jinbei is over here looking at Nami hit Luffy and is all like, "Nami, you need to stop, like, yo, chill." You know, everybody else is like, "Nah, yo, bro, you're not used to this. You never seen this before." So when he sees her rage, he mistakes it for Conqueror's Haki, which was pretty funny. After that, we finally get some bounties. I'm over here expecting some big jumps for what they've accomplished in Wano. Taking down two emperors. Chopper has a 1000 berry bounty. He's happy with it because he'll take what he can get. Nami actually surprised me because she actually has 366 million. She's over here freaking out and saying that it's in the hundreds of millions. Meanwhile, Brook is at 383 million, respectable amount. He's just happy to be around. Interestingly, Frankie, who is at 394 million, is not only upset at the amount, but he's also upset specifically that there's this new image that they're using for his bounty. Instead of using the cyborg, they're using a picture of the Sunny. I'm sure that's supposed to be set up for something. My guess is that Oda is either planting a joke or the government mistakes Frankie for the Sunny, as in, like, Frankie is a robot that can transform into the boat, which would be cool actually now that I think about it. Moving on, Usopp is now at the same amount that Luffy had after finishing with Dressrosa. 500 million, which he deserves. I mean, he is a god after all, am I right? So I might as well have the same bounty as the sun god. Robin is over here just happy feeding Chopper cotton candy with a bounty of nearly a billion. I'm very happy for her, but I do think she should be up there in the billions because she's one of the few people, one of the only people that can read poneglyphs, a priority target for the world government. So she's at 930 million. Pretty good. She can do better. Funnily enough, Sanji, who beat Zoro last time with his bounty, is now not number two, but number four. Behind who? Behind Jinbei. And he's so upset about it. He's upset. He's mad at Jinbei for just being in the way, because Jinbei is just over here like a wall. And he doesn't even care about his own bounty. Jinbei just saw his bounty. He's like, yeah. Speaking of which, Jinbei's bounty is a billion and 100 million. Zoro's right on top of that with 1 billion, 100 million, and 100. He's over here laughing at Sanji's misery, just dying, calling Sanji the number four of the crew. Pretty funny in of itself. Again, as we know, Luffy is at 3 billion, which I personally think is too low for him. For all of his accomplishments, he doesn't deserve to have the same bounty as Kid and Law. Meanwhile, at Empty Bluffs Island, we see the Cross Guild. It turns out that it was established by Crocodile and Mihawk. All Buggy did was steal the clout, so now Crocodile and Mihawk both want to kill him. Galdino betrays Buggy for Crocodile. Even Buggy's crew is over here switching sides. We see a flashback to Gloom Island with Mihawk, where we see the incident with the warlords. Crocodile proposes Mihawk with an alliance because they're both careful with who they trust. And on top of that, Mihawk was known as a marine hunter, as it's just been revealed to us. This is pretty cool because it stands in contrast to Zoro, who used to be known as the pirate hunter. We see a flashback and all the marine ships are pulling up to Buggy. Then Crocodile comes out of nowhere and starts sinking all the ships. Buggy's crew thought that Crocodile was here to fight with his brother in arms, but it turns out that Crocodile just wanted to pull up on Buggy, collect his money so that he can start up a new company, Cross Guild. Buggy has nothing to give. Buggy's delivery is failing ever since the giants left to join the Straw Hats, so he offers his own self as well as his crew to work for Crocodile by printing ads and delivering all over the world. So they do it. It turns out that one of Buggy's workers put Buggy's face front and center, giving the idea that Buggy is on top of Crocodile and Mihawk leading them, which led to both being upset at him and wanting to kill him. I do think that is pretty funny. Even Buggy was like, no, 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 no. But it turns out it was all over the world already. At Marine HQ, we see Buggy being given all the clout by Brand New for Impel Down, an equal to Shanks being on Roger's ship, but most importantly, Cross Guild. Then the bounties of the warlords are revealed to us, with Crocodile being 1,965,000,000. Mihawk, however, is at 3.5 billion and 90 million, a respectable amount for the warlord. Right below Shanks's bounty bounty, displaying how powerful Mihawk as a lone wolf truly is. Branu then reveals that Mihawk even surpasses Shanks in swordsmanship, which was a very surprising statement to make because Shanks himself fights with swords. So if Mihawk surpasses Shanks in swordsmanship, wouldn't that imply that Mihawk is stronger than Shanks? Period? Surprisingly, Buggy is now not only above Luffy, Law, and Kid, but he's getting threatened by Crocodile. Emperor Buggy is over here at 3.1 billion and 89 million, right above Straw Hat Luffy, his fellow emperor. Why am I saying it as if I'm a narrator or something? Crocodile is over here pissed that he's getting all this clout. Meanwhile, Mihawk doesn't even want to be an emperor. He just wants a peaceful life. So he convinces Crocodile to not kill Buggy and instead use Buggy to draw away all the attention. Meanwhile, at the revolutionary base at Kamabaka Queendom, Koala, who is over here worried about Sabo, is getting reassured by Ivankov. The commanders also seem to be worried, but Karasu is confident that Sabo did the right thing, and he believes in him regardless. Dragon shows up and he's over here like, Sabo is fine. However, if Sabo killed the king of Alabasta, if he killed Cobra, then I will never forgive him no matter what. So it gives us a better idea where Dragon truly is. Despite his impression of the king being a world noble, he would still not want Sabo to kill him. So he goes up to Kuma and asks him, Kuma, what did you see? Kuma is over here unable to respond because all he says is, your wish is my command. He's over here still under the programming of the celestial dragons. Finally, Sabo calls and Koala picks up right away. However, that call does seem to be intercepted by the other marines. It pains me to say that we have a break next week, but Oda does deserve it, let's be honest. The man works like a mule. This chapter was packed. It gave us a lot of world building, a lot of answers. It makes me think for some reason that we might be headed to a revolutionary arc. Now that I think about it, the revolutionary army, they've always been underdeveloped throughout the story. Most of the development seems to be happening off screen. So hopefully the Straw Hats maybe meet up with Sabo next arc, or it leads to something that could help us get to know these characters better and actually witness their growth on screen. Anyways, back chapter, Straw Hat bounties, funny. Mihawk and Crocodile with Buggy was even funnier. We get to see the Warlord bounties as well. That was great. Very, very satisfactory chapter to end off on. Take your break, Oda. You deserve it. The common question of the day is, where do you think we're headed to next? Let me know in the comment section below. Thank you for watching. Like and subscribe, and have a good one.